नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट थ्री वाइटल कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ डाइजेस्टन दैट डिटरमिन मोस्ट डिजीजेस दैट अकर इन द डिरेंज्ड स्टेट और द स्टेट्स ऑफ विशिएटेड और एक्सेसरबेटेड दोषास. दीज थ्री थिंग्स दैट वी विल टॉक अबाउट टुडे are number one Agni, number two Oj, and number three the state of derangement of Agni called Ama, and how there are certain factors such as prana or the foods we eat that will help us overcome the formation of Ama. So let's first define these three items and see what are the correlations that lead to the derangement of doshas and disease or vriddhi. So Agni is very simple. It's one of the Mahabhut. Bhumi Rapo Nano Vayu Kham Mano Buddhi Revcha. So Bhumi Rapo Nal. Nal is Agni or the Mahabhut or transformation. What are the characteristics of Agni? We had talked earlier. Agni has four primordial characteristics. Agni is Ushna, Tikshna, Laghu, and Dravya, which means it is Ushna, hot, Tikshna, fast, Laghu, light, or easily digestible, and Dravya means the plasma state or the fluid state. Now, those are the characteristics that are required for breakdown of ahar or the intaken food into the catabolic components. The component of waste which is called kitta and the component of assimilation slash digestion which I will call rasa. The first dhatu, if you will. So those are the two main things that are formed from the action of Agni on Ahar. Okay, so let's first talk about the things that are formed from digestion. Now this digestion of or Agni, I should say, occurs in the Amashay, which is Ama is a place of lodging. Ashay means house. So why does it say Amashay? Well, if Agni is not working well, then the product that is left behind is the partially digested waste, which is called So Agni can be of four kinds. Samya Agni, when it is working in equilibrium. Tikshna Agni, which happens in Pitta people, which is very fast. Ushna and Tikshna component is very fast in that. So that is Tikshna Agni in Pitta dosha. Then there is Mand Agni, which is slow Agni. Agni is not very, like you say, people have slow metabolism. That refers to Mand Agni, Kapha Dosha. Whereas there can be Visham Agni, which is erratic, unpredictable, sometimes fast, sometimes slow, sometimes low quality, Visham Agni. That is Vayu, Vat. So you want the Agni to be Samya Agni. You don't want it to be Tikshna either. Tikshna Agni will have all the diseases of Pitta. So if the Agni is deranged, there will be diseases that will form because of the quality of Agni. These can be 20 Kaphaja diseases, 40 Pitta diseases, or 80 Vat diseases. So that is all related to the power of Agni and Agni being deranged. How do these happen? We will see right now. So Agni, when it acts on the ahar, breaks down into the waste products called kitta and the absorption digestion products called rasa. In the normal functioning state, the first dhatu or the assimilated product formed from Amashay, Jatharagni or Samyagni working in the right way is Rasa. Rasa can be thought as the first primordial soup from which all the dhatus or the life forces will generate. So these are representing the structural and functional units of life in different organ systems. That's what dhatu refers. Dhatu word translates into metal. So dhatu here means the thing that is forming the scaffold of this body and mind for this life. Okay, so they are the dhatus of life or the metals of life, if you will. So rasa is the first dhatu. Rasa, when should be most closely relates to kapha dosha. So rasa helps form all the, you can call it chail or chime, but these are more symbolic than real representation in the body. Like rakta, some people will say it is blood, but no, rakta just means carrier. Similarly, rasa means mucoid secretion. So, but if you want to think in terms of process of digestion biologically in modern medicine, then this is chyle, blood, muscle, fat, bone, marrow, semen / ovum. But if you think phenotypically, symbolically, metaphorically, allegorically, in terms of Ayurveda, this is more mucoid secretions, kapha dosha. This is more of the carrier of all the vital fluids, that is rakta dosh. And then these kind of go together with biology in terms of muscle, fat, bone, marrow, reproductive organ carrier cells. Okay, so those are the seven. Now, if at any point rasa has to be transformed to rakta, there has to be some waste. That waste is mal. That waste is mal. And that waste, in case of rakta, you can think about for the most part as secretions like purisa or the feces or anything that is undigested. But the accumulation of rasa will lead to what we call kapha dosh. So kapha dosh, if you have too much of rasa, will form, because what is the excess, exacerbation. Similarly, rakta, if there is rasa forming rakt, if there is very little waste being formed in the rasa and most of it is translated into rakta, or too much food being eaten, that's why rasa and rakta are forming, too much of rakta will lead to pitta dosh. Now you'll say, where is vat? Vat is not in these. Vat happens when the agni has baked the food very hard or too much, so that there is sublimation of the ahar or the food to form vayu, which is leading to the vat dosha. But in terms of the seven dhatus, the representation of rasa is with excess of rasa causes kapha dosha, excess of rakta causes pitta dosha. Excess of mamsa, that will be seen as excretion from the gyanendriyas. So things like nasal secretions or the teardrops or saliva or even those are the main ones, I would say. Now in terms of med, it's fat, the main secretion is sweat, waste. We're talking about wastes here. The asthi, nails and hair, those are the wastes. Majja, it is said that it is mostly the lubricating portion of the eye, as well as sebum. They call it tikta, and in Shukra there is no waste. Of course, it distills to form oja. So these are the ways. So when mans is formed, for instance, let's say there will be majority converted into med, but some of it will be given away as the gyanendriya, the senses. So I would say senses of senses secretion, you can say, such as you can think of rhinorrhea or the nasal secretions or saliva for that matter, you know. Similarly, med will form asthi, but some of it will give away as sweat. So you will see that some of it is together. It is going through dhatu, but there also these are formed. If you look through this pathway also, this is formed. But that is the way. That's why they say 40 drops of rakt forms one drop of shukra. Okay. So that brings me to a very important point. The most important end dhatu to be formed is shukra in males and avatakra in females. Now, Males and females are a little different. You will talk about semen retention in males. Females cannot say that we will hold our menses, right? So there's nothing to do with the menstrual cycle. It is to do more with the number of andanu or the oocytes or the ovary, I should say, that the oocytes in the ovaries that the female is born with, whether it is 400 or whatever that number is. Okay, so Shukra, you cannot waste Shukra. That's why a lot of Ayurvedic practices will talk about semen retention, celibacy or brahmacharya, and using sexual energy only to procreate kids and not for fun all the time. And the reason for that is if there is too much of emaciation of the dhatu, then there is weakening of the scaffold. The body is weak, the mind is weak. And once the end dhatu is weak, the oj goes down. What is oj? Oj is the ultimate distillate product of all the metals that will go back into the main channels. So when you talk about Ida, Pingla, Sushumna, what flows up the Sushumna, interspersed by the chakras, is the oj. So you want the oj to flow up and not flow down through the urethra into the toilet. So that is important. That's why we want the oj to ascend as much as we can, of course. Now, oj can be seen. That's why when it is ascending slowly, you can see that there are visible morphological changes in the individual, like the brightness of the eye. Ever looked at a picture of Yogananda? His eyes are so twinkling with energy. That kind of bright shine in the eyes will be seen also in people with kaphaja, because they are generally natural oj, or any person who is undergoing semen retention. So that the highest concentrated dhatu can ascend along the sushumna and create this brightness as it ascends. That brightness glow is seen as the twinkle in the eye, or teja, as if you will say. Sometimes it will be seen as the luster of the skin, perspicacious wisdom that individual has, the cognition he has, and also hyperacute senses. All those things are manifestations of high quality oja that individual has. Now, if oja is depleted because of too much of sexual practices, PMO, then the individual will become asthenic or weak, and there will be features of increased vat, because that individual has lost the heavy metal, you so to say. So there's predominance of the kapha. Oja closely resembles kapha. If you want to think about oja, think kapha. If you want to think about prana, you think about vayu. If you want to think about agni, think about pitta. That is the way I want you to think. Vat in the most distillate form is prana, movement. Pitta, most distillate form is agni, digestion, catabolism. Oja, most distillate form is kaphaja. Most distillate form is oja, nutrition. So in a way, oja can be, if you are not think in terms of Ida, Pingla, Sushumna, oja represents kaphaja. Oja wants to nourish, heal, protect, support, shelter, pacify, relax, lunar, Ida. Whereas the solar Pingla is represented by Agni, expose, violate, destroy, invigorate, those kind of features. Okay, so that is oja. Now, oja, they say, they can be of two types. They call it para oja and apara oja, but basically the para oja or the tejas is what is fixed in the heart that we are born with based on our karma, and apara oja is what can be formed through these dhatus. And this is the oja that is in flux. It might increase or decrease based on what you are eating, how much you are meditating, what quality of life you are living. So what happens? Why is oja important? We talked about enlightenment. It helps with enlightenment, but think about it. The oja is basically ascending from the lower chakras, Muladhara, all the way up to the Swadhisthana, to the Sahasrara, right? So Sahasrara, if it goes, there's enlightenment. What happens when it passes through all these chakras in between? The sacral plexus, Swadhisthana, or the Manipura, the Anhata, the Vishuddha, Ajna. Well, every time there is some sort of enlightenment happening. So there is increased creation, creativity zyada padegi. Then there will be increased ambition or wanting to change the world in a meaningful way on the Manipura. comes to Dhanhata, he is full of love. When you're sitting with him, you're also full of love. That kind of diffusion of compassion, empathy and love on the Anhata or the drum heart. Then there is the Vishuddha, the courage to only speak truth and stay with the truth. And then the Ajna, the intuition, the ability to know Dharma, the ability to know what is right versus wrong, those things. And Sahasrara is of course enlightenment. So those are the things that are happening. But as I said, it also happens to hit the third chakra, which is the Manipura. And the Manipura is the solar plexus where the Pingla or the solar is located, right? So that's why it activates the Agni. And that is why Oja will activate your Agni. So I told you about one method, how you can increase the Agni is by, well, eating the right foods and not destroying the semen or the avatakra, but more importantly, through increasing the Oja. Second method of increasing the Agni is through prana. Now, aham hi vaishvanaro bhutva prayanam dehi majita pranapan samanyam pachamyam chadurudam. God says that I am the Agni in your belly that helps to digest the food. Pranapan, all the different kinds of prana. There are 5 kinds of pranas. Prana, udana, apana, vyana, samana. But basically, today we want to understand that prana is the most distillate form of vata energy. Prana represents perfect circulation. So prana, when you are doing things like bhastrika, or Kapal Bharti, or Anulom Vilom, what you are doing is you are activating the Agni, the Jatharagni in the Amashaya. The Jatharagni is activated, your fire is burning the right way. Because remember, Pitta has three components. It is made up of Agni, it is made up of water or up, and it is made up of little bit of Vayu. So all these things are there. That's why Pitta is a dosh. Dosh is a defect. When they are in the perfect form, they become Agnis. Okay? So, let's see. Pitta is going to form your food. If the Pitta is doshed, then it will not form the food. So, you want to correct your Agni. The second modality is through Prana, which is Pranayam. So, all those Bhastrika, Kapal Bharti, Anulom Vilom will help to make our Agni better. Very important. The whole story starts with Agni. If the Agni is right, you will not be in disease state. That's the whole point of Ayurveda. Ayurveda means Agni. How to make your Agni strong and not too strong. So that is the point. You have to make it Samya Agni. That can be done through enhancement of Oja and through enhancement of Pranayam. You can do those two activities. A third way is through activation of certain foods which are known to enhance the Agni. So these are the things which have the same character as Agni. Agni is what? Ushna, Tushna, Laghu. So you can think about foods like that, sour, bitter, pungent, spicy. These are kind of going to rev up the Agni. Similarly, ghee is a great way of enhancing your Agni. That's why we say use less of refined oils, but you should use more of ghee. Because ghee is going to reduce all the three doshas, but more so activate the Agni and inhibit the formation of Ama. So I told you all this story, how to activate the Agni. Because if Agni is not activated, you have formation of Ama, and Ama leads to diseases. So let's talk about Ama. What are the characteristics of Agni? 4. Ushna, Tikshna, Laghu, and Dravya. Just the opposite 4 are Ama. Whereas Agni is fast, hot, light. Ama is heavy, Pichila. Remember Pichila? Vishad and Pichila? Pichila is slimy and Vishad is like Akash, friction. So Ama is Guru, which is heavy or difficult to digest. It is Pichila, which is slimy. It is Mand, it is slow moving. So, and the Sheath, which is cold. So let me write those 4, otherwise we will forget. So there is Pichila, which means it is slimy. It is Mand, which means it is slow. And then there is Guru, which means it is difficult to digest, and Sheath, which means it is cold. All these 4 are similar to the properties of Kapha, if you think. So in a way, Ama characteristically, very closely resembles Kapha. But the problem is, kapha is a dosha, but still it is one of the ingredients of the body, acceptable and best ingredients. If you have to have the dosha, the best dosha to have is kapha, because these are the individuals which are well built, strong immunity, lot of oja. But ama is the distorted state, because it is partially digested, putrefying food sitting in the stomach that is causing fermentation, formation of air, vata increasing, it is causing disturbance of the agni, the pitta is dying and becoming pitta dosha, and it is blocking the flow of the kapha through the srota, hence the kapha is aggravated. So you see how ama is tridosha aggravator. It starts with aggravation of kapha, because what ama does is that it increases the blockage along the channels. This oj has to flow through these channels to form these different dhatus, and it has flow through these channels to reach the agni, to potentiate the agni. If you block the flow through the srota, then you get formation because of ama. If you block the flow, then agni is not formed, so agni is weakened further. See how it's a vicious cycle. Oja feeds agni, agni breaks down products to form more elements of oja, which are forming the vessel in which the agni can operate. So agni and oja feed back each on another, but agni is the primordial thing that helps us to digest the things and ward off diseases. Once the agni is weakened for whatever reason, and if you listen to Chanakya, if you listen to Charak, he will talk about wisdom, tranquility, contentment, and avoiding lust, anger, and greed. Those are the spiritual or the sukshma sharir elements that help to potentiate the agni. In the sthul sharir, I would say, as I told you before, you can do things which are going to potentiate the agni, are the ghee, or the ati ushna tikshna foods, or the sour, spicy foods, ghee, oj elevation, and pranayama. Now, when those things don't happen, the ama, which is the semi-digested rotting food sitting in the amashay or the stomach, is not leaving the pylorus, it is fermenting, forming vata, all the diseases happen. So all those four diseases are characteristics of kapha, but in the deranged state, they are characteristics of all the they are the reason for all the diseases we have. The 80 vata disorders, 40 pitta disorders, and 20 kapha disorders. So when ama is formed, it blocks the flow of kapha through the natural channels. Hence, it cannot reach and grow the agni, and the ama is growing itself. And that's why ama is clogging everywhere. That's why the kapha diseases happen. Kapha disorders, remember, we talked about kapha diseases happen from congestion. Pitta diseases happen from hyperactivity, pro-inflammation. And vata diseases happen from degeneration. Kapha mostly happens in the cuff area, the respiratory symptoms, or because of congestion or blockage of the flow. Whereas pitta happens mostly in the skin and the heart, because hridaya, pleasing, pitta, that kind of food. And vata is mostly neuropsych degenerative disorders or the joint disorders. That's a very broad categorization. Anybody can invert in anybody, but those are the main ways. The most disorders that happen from old age, ruksh, vishad, are the vata disorders. Vata is composed of vayu and akash. Whereas pitta is the medium ones. 40 disorders can happen from the composition of vayu, fire, water, and little bit of air. Whereas kapha is mostly earth and little bit of water. So those diseases happen from ama. Now, let us summarize everything that I said here, so that we kind of know how to deal with diseases going forward. The body has to have a very strong agni, the digestive fire that helps to digest any ahar. Ahar in, I put yagna here, because ahar should be eaten with humility, because ahar has this component of nourishing our food by giving up its own identity. So see, there's identity destruction. So we have to have humility because of the sacrifice of the yajna, the food has been made. That's why we offer to God before we eat. You have to give it to God before you eat the food. So that is ahar. Now the agni has to be strong. Agni is located in the epigastrium or the amashay. It has to be samyagni. If it is erratic, it is called visham agni of vayu. If it is very strong, it is called Tikshna Agni of Pitta. If it is very slow, it is called Mand Agni of Kapha. In all those cases, it will cause 80 Vata disorders of joints, neuropsychiatry, delirium, neuropathy, paralysis, or Pitta, hyperactivity, urticaria, pro-inflammatory, or Kapha, mostly congestion, cough, asthma, bronchospasm, those kind of disorders. Okay. So you want a very strong Agni. Agni can be strengthened by three major modalities on the sthul sharir. By pranayama, bhastrika and all the related anulom vilom kapal bharti. By ingestion of foods that enhance the Agni, such as ghee and spicy, hot, sour, fermented foods. And third way of enhancing Agni is by increasing the oja. The easiest way would be semen retention. Now, when the Agni digests the ahar, there is formation of assimilated digested products through the seven dhatus ending in oja, which will replete the Agni again, and the formation of wastes, which can be called kitta, which can be purisa or feces, mutra or sweat, and swed as sweat. Mutra as urine and swed as sweat. Now, if there is a formation of from one dhatu to the next, you have to have a waste product of mal, and that will lead to the formation of the next dhatu. And the last dhatu to form is shukra dhatu. 40 drops of blood will form one drop of shukra, and that is why semen retention is said to be helping in growth of the oja, the vibrancy, the twinkling light in the eyes, the glow in the skin, the acuity of thought, and the acuity of the senses. Hope you like this video. Please feel free to leave your comments below. Thank you.